Hello, fellow loonies. You're listening to Into the Night, a Moon Knight podcast. This is episode 18. I'm one of your hosts, Rey.
I'm Rebecca.
And I'm your final host, Connor. And this week, we're reviewing the dynamic new issue of the Bemis and Burrows run, Moon Knight issue 189. We have a fantastic spotlight on probably one of the longest-running Moon Knight villains, Bushman, and possibly a Pop Funko review. So sit back, relax, grab your issues out, get your Khonshu on.
Yes, welcome back, everyone. Hi, Rebecca, how are you? Welcome back.
I'm good, good.
That's good, that's good. Yes, and Connor, how are you?
I am doing rather well. It is a million degrees in this room, but I have two separate cups of ice cold water, so I am more than ready to go.
Awesome. Is it cold over your way, Rebecca? Or?
It's so cold. We have frost. We have frost outside right now.
Oh,
we're apparently heading for our coldest winter for a decade.
Oh gosh.
Oh, wow. Yes, you can. It's not exciting.
I was about to say we should.
It's a
probably,
little bit exciting.
I was about to say we should probably just talk to each other about each of our own, you know, the weathers that we have, and kind of appease each other with how, you know, cool or how hot it is. Yeah.
Funnily enough, the last bad winter we had, my partner was over in Australia for and kept going, "It's so hot," and I'd be like, "Look at my 4-foot icicle."
Yeah, we tend to be in sharp contrast with each other. Anyway, loonies, welcome back to episode 18 now. And as Connor mentioned, we're going to launch into very exciting to have the Bemis and Burrows second issue. So we're looking forward to reviewing that. As always, it will be kind of like a conventional review. Part one, we always do the panel by panel breakdown, but we'll get into the bare bones, the aspects, and also the crescent dart ratings for that one. But before we get into that, I guess one of the big things that dropped this week was the Avengers Infinity War trailer, and I'm taking it both of you have seen it.
Several
Just a
times.
Couple of times.
Yeah, okay, that was my next question. Yeah, how many times? General thoughts. What do you think, Rebecca? First off, of what you saw.
I just want these films now. No, it was a great trailer. It was a great trailer. It feels like we're culminating, like it's culminating to something big, and that's the sense they got across, both with the teaser trailer and then with the trailer. I don't think they gave very much of the story away, which is great. It was just nice to see them all together again. And, like, there's a sense of dread.
Yeah.
There's a sense of sadness about it.
Yeah.
And it all sort of captured it perfectly for me. A bit of excitement, a bit of sadness, a bit of, oh, my God, what's going to happen?
Yeah.
Which has launched a billion speculations, even in my head. I've already plotted out the next two games. So.
Yeah, yeah. There were some juicy bits in it, and... Yeah, and it definitely has that buzz of I guess when we first, you know, in the MCU got all the singular heroes together for the Avengers. To me, it's kind of got that kind of buzz as well. But at the same time, as you know, the likes of seeing Doctor Strange amongst them and even Spider-Man, they fit in really well, I think. So it's really assuring. I guess the trailer for what we are going to get in April next year.
We get it April, America. You get it May. Don't worry.
Yeah, right. and Connor, how about you? What were your thoughts?
Yeah, you guys covered it pretty well. I love the trailer. I agree. It's got that kind of sort of this real hype behind it, but it also seems like a really sort of dire movie too. You know, it's still sort of bleak, and it'll be a big struggle for these heroes that we've really seen grow. And I love Spider-Man so much, and he'll be there, he'll be hanging out, he'll be shooting his webs. And I mean, I really do just love all of these. They've all, even as someone who probably a couple of years ago wasn't even that sold on the MCU or wasn't that big a fan, like, it's just progressed to a point where I just love all these characters, I love where they're at, I love how they're portrayed, and I just cannot wait.
Yeah.
And we got Black Panther before that, too, so...
I'm so excited.
What a good time.
I was about to say as well, Black Panther, we've only seen him in Civil War, like, as a cameo. And yet again, yeah, he slots right in into the... And it seems like he's...
And we love him so much already.
Yeah. Oh, I cannot wait for the Black Panther trailer. Those trailers have been...
And I don't know if you saw, they announced overnight last night, so... Yeah. That Ant-Man and the Wasp is going to be a rom-com.
Oh, great. Oh, that puts a smile on my face.
And it just made me think that, like, what we've got coming up is we've got Black Panther, which I think is going to be quite serious. Yeah. Infinity War, which I think is going to be quite serious.
Yeah.
And it's like, and then they sort of wham us with Ant-Man and the Wasp as a sort of rom-com, but they've already said it's very much going to, you know, impact what goes forward with Avengers 4. And then, so it's just like, I just think it's so clever of them to break it up with a sort of comedic one.
Yeah, that's right.
Like, so it makes the sort of all the seriousness hit harder. Do you know what I mean? It's just like, and it's just like, there's going to be a lot of people complaining about a rom-com, I'm sure. But I mean, given that you've got like two potential couples in Ant-Man and the Wasp that are described by the title Ant-Man and the Wasp, it's just, I don't know. I just like going, they're very assured, and they've kind of, you know, whatever you think about the individual films, it's such an achievement.
Oh yeah,
that I think. The Infinity War is, it deserves the hype, whether it's good or bad.
Oh, for sure. And it just shows that Marvel are not afraid to, I guess because they've established such a, you know, again, you hear a lot of people saying they've earned it. They've established this kind of universe and they can now start playing around with all sorts of genres. So, yeah, that just puts a smile on my face. A rom-com Ant-Man, that sounds so apt for it as well. I mean,
it
really
does as well. It's just, oh, and then we've got Captain Marvel and then Avengers 4, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. Captain Marvel with Jude Law in there. So, gosh, everything's just, it's, Marvel is really, they've got a stranglehold on things. I really do hope DC as well. I mean, look, I didn't mind Justice League, you know, there were kind of lesser, better ones. But yeah, I mean, they're trying to do
that. I thought Justice League was honestly fine. Enjoyable.
Yeah,
like, and exactly. My quibbles with it are minor enough that I'd have the same quibbles with any film. And I agree, I want DC to come out that gate and just... I want them to find their own voice.
Yes,
like,
rather
I want them
than...
to know where they want to go. And they don't have to... And maybe that voice is not connecting the films and just giving us kick-ass films.
Oh, yeah, which
they've stated.
Because I
want to see those characters done well.
Yeah, and they've stated that, right? They've said that... Someone said that...
I think it's rumoured that that's what might happen, given the number of films they've announced and the difficulty you would have connecting all those films, including sort of multiple Joker films, multiple Harley films.
Yeah.
That maybe they'll just say, let's make good films that are in the DC world and kind of do what we've done with the animated ones.
Yeah.
Which, DC's animated films are off the chart good.
Yeah.
You know, like, just give people what they want from the comics and not worry about trying to do what Marvel have done, because they can still be great films and they'll still all be DC films.
That's right.
But connecting films is... I think Marvel have found it difficult, and I think... or increasingly difficult, especially with, like, Robert Downey Jr.'s pay going up, but all of their pay going up. And I think maybe when Feige talks about the MCU going forward and saying it's going to be very different, that we might get much more what we just saw in Thor, which is a couple of them together, but not this massive group ups.
And that's
a lot. And it takes very special filmmakers to get that right.
True. And it still works with a reduced, you know, with a guest appearance here and there.
It works great. Look at Winter Soldier's their highest rated one, and that's just... three of them, isn't it? It's just Sam, Steve, and Natasha.
Mm-hmm. And I'd imagine it's a lot easier to write for, and everyone gets a decent, you know, from an acting point of view, everyone gets a decent slab at it. So, I mean, also just kind of pulling it back into, I guess, Infinity War and into the street level heroes. Did anyone see someone made that fan made trailer where they included the Defenders in there?
I did.
Oh, no. Oh, I did. It just made me sad seeing it, I'm not going to lie.
It made me a little sad seeing it.
Oh, really? Yeah. I mean, it was fun to see.
I'm not 100% certain we won't see something like that. I think it's more like to be in Avengers 4.
Okay, because that was where I was kind of leading towards. I was wondering, is there any possible chance, like anything that
would, I think so.
Yeah, that would get a nod, at least a nod. Like even if it isn't, you know, Daredevil, Luke Cage, Jessica Jones, even if it's one of the secondary cast members or something. Yeah, I think.
No, you mean even if it's someone like Moon Knight?
No.
No, I was thinking more like someone like Karen Page.
I was about to say Sam Stein, but he. Anyway, but it's like I've got to reel that in. He's like Karen Page, yeah, exactly. Or yes. What's that guy's name? Ellis, the reporter.
No, I think honestly, I think if we get any of it, it'll be one of the heroes.
Okay.
Because from what I understand, or what I heard it once that explained why it's so difficult to get them in.
Yeah.
And it's to do with actors' contracts and
yes.
different rates of pay you have to give them if they perform that character in a different medium.
Yeah, that's what I heard as well.
Which means it's much easier to separate them. So I think if you're going to get Karen Page, you might as well go Daredevil. Like, you know, it's the same issue. So
yeah.
So like, just I kind of want the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. in there more.
Oh, that would be good. Yeah, I mean. Yeah, how about something like that, or Cloak and Dagger, or, you know, the other...
Yeah.
Those would be cool.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's out of the question.
Yeah, okay, well...
Especially if it was a very quick clip that it didn't actually have to be the same actor in.
Yeah, I'm going to hold you to that, Rebecca.
Okay. I'm always hopeful about seeing everyone I love together.
Yeah, me too.
That said, too, on the subject of, like, the MCU Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. return this week, I didn't watch it, but positive reception so is good. Great.
Was it
and
good?
And Runaways sounds like it's doing pretty well as well.
Mm-hmm.
Have you been watching Runaways as well, Rebecca?
Maybe.
How about Gifted? Maybe. Is Gifted still on?
Gifted, I think, took a break.
Okay. Yeah,
I don't think there's been an episode for a couple of weeks, or for a week at least. So.
Gosh, I've got to catch up with all of them. I'm only up to episode 3 of Inhumans. Did you finish Inhumans? Oh. Anyone? Rebecca?
Yeah, of course I did.
Yeah, well, yeah, was it good? what were the overall?
It's not great.
Oh.
It's
did
not
it get
great.
Better?
It got better in the middle, and then kind of by the end,
I think
the last two episodes may have involved a lot of shouting at the TV.
Oh, fizzled.
Of like, why would he do that? Why is she doing that? But, you know, I like the characters, and yeah. I think the actors did a good job with the characters and what they had. And it's a shame, because I love the Inhumans, and Lockjaw was awesome.
You reckon there might be a season 2, or...?
I don't... Things. So I think if there was going to be one, we'd have probably had it announced by now. But I did jokingly say that Black Bolt should turn up at the end of Infinity War and scream at Thanos. Yeah.
Get Lockjaw to come up and take on Thanos. That'd be cool.
Oh, you mean as in the Ryan North one page?
Yeah.
Where he steals Thanos' glove.
Yeah. Or in the Pet Avengers, which we read recently.
Yeah,
Pet
Avengers. That's what we should really have going on. But I mean, who knows? But Marvel certainly has a big playground.
They certainly do, and. And look, I guess we really have to kind of angle it back towards the main topic of this podcast, Moon Knight. So a bit of a nice segue here. If we go into the news articles that we have, and we've just touched upon it, I guess, just then, about the new Avengers 4 set and rumours of Jeremy Renner, the rumours of Ronan. So... Connor or Rebecca, do you mind just describing? Are you familiar with Ronan or
not even slightly?
I know of his existence. It's Hawkeye going underground, and that's when Kate takes on the name Hawkeye, isn't it? While he's going off doing his things as Ronan in Japan.
Yes, and he is very mysterious.
The costume he is in the Vanity Fair pictures, etc., are all very much Ronan style.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's quite exciting. In the article as well, there's a touches a little upon, there's a mention of Moon Knight, hence it comes up in my alerts thing. But Moon Knight did feature in in that comic run as well with Ronan.
And
Echo as well. But look, I don't think there's any connection there with possibly seeing, you know, Moon Knight in Avengers 4. But still an interesting article, I guess, nevertheless. I'm a big fan of Hawkeye. Hawkeye's a pretty... he's kind of like that everyday man, you know. He's actually mixing it amongst... and I can imagine if it is the likes of, say Daredevil or Moon Knight in the Avengers, Hawkeye's the closest thing to it, because he literally just a guy who, you know, can actually shoot, you know, shoot well, but that's about it. And he's made fun of it himself in the Avengers movie, you know, saying I'm just a guy with a bow and arrow going against. Yeah. I think that was in Ultron. So, yeah, a bit of an interesting article there. A slight nod to Moon Knight. But how about the next one, Connor? We have for the news.
Yeah, nice little article in general talking about. The DCEU more so bringing in the like first ever Jewish hero in the form of Shazam, and referencing also as well Flash being Jewish in the Justice League movie, and then of course our very own Jewish hero Moon Knight. I guess that's connection. I disagree
with it though.
Yeah.
Because we've had Fantastic Four films, and certainly in the last one, which was terrible, Ben Grimm was certainly Jewish.
Oh, that's true. Yes. Yeah.
So.
Well, yeah. This article is... Oh, yeah, it features Silver Screen. Silver Screen's first Jewish. Yeah. And the reason why I pointed this out was more... I remember Doug Monch, in one of his interviews, claimed that Moon Knight was the first Jewish superhero. Not, you know, if you take away the silver screen thing, but...
yeah.
And I was just looking at the other... They have a list. I can't seem to get it on the tablet here with the rest of the article.
Even Ben Grimm was retconned to be Jewish.
Yeah.
I believe. Originally Jewish, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, because, yeah, you're right, because he came before Moon Knight by a decade or so. I can't get this... thing to work. Sorry, Connor, have you got the list of who the Jewish heroes are?
No, it got us. What was it? Subscriber blocked.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting as
there's,
well.
There's Wiccan and Hulkling. Well, there's Wiccan.
Okay, Steve. Yes. Very young though.
Songbird.
Yeah. Right. Okay, I didn't know that.
But I think Moon Knight. Swings that, unless you, and like I said, I believe Ben Grimm was retconned to be Jewish.
Right, yeah.
Kitty Pryde.
Oh, yeah, she's 70s, right? Yeah, 70s as well.
Yeah. There's got to be others. Oh, one of A-Force, is it Sasquatch?
One of them, yes. Okay. Okay, right. Yep. I can't remember his name. He's got a Polish name. Anywho,
it's not an area I know very well. I know I should know all the Jewish heroes. I just know the ones I like.
Anyway, so that's it has a little spiel there on Moon Knight. So that's pretty cool. Rebecca, the next article that we've got on the list:
the 8 comics you should read this week from comicbook.com.
I mean,
let's have a look. Oh, well, they're pretty good. Let's have a look at them. Obviously, they mentioned Moon Knight. You wouldn't have linked to it. Yeah. Motor Crush 8.
Oh, yeah. Anyone read that?
Yeah, I'm loving that series. That is a really fun and weird series, actually. But it's kind of that classic image flair of kind of crazy concept with great creators making great books.
Yeah.
That's cool. That is a great creative team. Dark Hawk 51.
Oh, yes, great. I haven't read it yet.
Oh, I didn't read that. Oh, my God,
it was
Connor,
great. I wasn't expecting it to be great, but it was great.
Really? Okay, I'm excited.
Yeah,
then.
It was fun. I don't know where this music is coming from.
Oh.
Jean Grey.
Yeah, Jean Grey. I read
great.
The
great book. Yep.
Yeah, it is a good book, isn't it? It's one of those small ones that you don't really
wasn't expecting it to be good at all.
Yeah, and then what's it? Kaiju
Max season 3, number 5. I've never even heard of that.
No.
It's like, it's basically sort of like a prison story, but involving like kaiju, so like, you know, those really classic Japanese monsters. Not actually referencing like Godzilla, but sort of like your giant...
I love the warning on the front cover, though. It's suggested for mature readers for kaiju drug use, made up cuss words, copious blood and guts.
Yeah.
They could probably sell me on that. Dragon Ball Super.
There's quite a vast range here, isn't there? It's,
there's a really, John Wick number one, which is the new Greg Pak, right?
It's
been getting a lot of good buzz. I didn't really fancy it.
The comic or the movies? I haven't seen the movie either.
Nah, the thing is that, like, I think it released in America a long time before it did for us, and it had such hype by the time.
Yeah, that was a terrible
one. Such hype before it got to here that when I went to see it, I was just like, it's all right.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's not the second coming, but it's fine. You know, like, Moon Knight.
Yeah, Moon Knight, yeah, which we'll get into soon, Loonies. Just bear with us.
Yeah.
We're getting there.
Still getting its positive buzz.
Yeah, which is great.
Green Arrow Annual.
Okay. Has anyone read...
And Batman Creature of the Night.
Does anyone read Green Arrow the Annual? How does that rate against a TV show?
I haven't been, but I know that, again, people in the Serious Issues groups have been really saying that Green Arrow is great in Rebirth.
Oh, okay. So, cool. Cool.
And, it's on my
Batman...
list.
Oh. Sorry.
No, it's all right. It's me going speeding through them.
Oh, no, I was just saying, and Batman Creature of the Night was
just
absolutely 10 out of 10. That is... If you love comic books, just read that. It's just...
A lot of people have been talking about it. Yeah. Mm. Yeah, I might have to pick that
and
one up.
And that's a real 1-2 whammy with Moon Knight.
Oh, okay.
Just, yeah.
I think they fit very well together for obvious reasons and not because it's about Batman. there's some very interesting thematic similarities.
Right, cool. Yeah, no, that looks good. And did we mention the other one?
Oh, the last one, Zagus,
which I have absolutely zero idea of what that is. But it looks pretty funky. There's
It does look funky. Yeah. Funky art.
Yeah.
It's the discovery of the week, according to them.
Yeah, if you guys have... So, I mean, it's kind of indie popular, a comic called Copra. It's like, I forget the creator's name. But it's like his sort of fun little take on the Suicide Squad, and it is very good. And this, like, graphic
I've heard
novels,
it's
like,
amazing.
All his work. Yeah, it really is. And this graphic novel, Zagus, is just like all his work before he did Copra. Copra.
Right.
Is Copra. Mikkel Fiff? Is that him? Yeah, cool.
Michelle.
Yes.
Lovely. Well, okay. I mean, well,
I might
look into that, yeah. You know, I just picked this one from comicbook.com, but there are a lot of reviews on Moon Knight issue 189, which we will get into. The last two articles that of note were what we discussed just at the beginning of the episode about the Infinity War trailer dropping. Which has been massively viewed and was what the highest trailer in 24 hours to
ever.
Be viewed so ever.
Hours, yeah.
By
so,
a big margin, I think, too. Like a
yeah, it was by 40
100 million views.
Yeah.
No, I think it was by 40 million. I think it was like 190 to 230.
Wow, and that was like the thank yous from Marvel were the most prominent. I thought like, you know, it's always good to hear.
The teaser trailer before that was talking about it all coming to an end with all the YouTube people.
Yeah.
Getting
oh,
excited.
That was so sweet. Yeah.
It was so sweet. And then afterwards, the thank you for making it. And it was just like, aww.
Yeah, it was such a, yeah, it was very kind of like in your face in a good way. It was good. Yeah, and Connor, the last article, I mean, we don't want to say too much.
Yeah, this is... Bleeding Cool, who got the first ever Moon Knight, like, 188 review out, is coming back with another Moon Knight 189 review, and it is just as glowing. So, give that one a read by Joshua Davidson.
Yes, and you know, from what we hear on the internet and all the reviews, Moon Knight by Bemis and Burroughs is still going really, really well. So with that, I think it's time to go over the moon. Huh. For Over the Moon, this episode, we, as mentioned, we're doing Crazy Runs in the Family Part 2. And we have another special guest narrator with us. And it's something a little different again. We all remember last week, Wayne from Courtside Podcast did a fantastic job with his two narrations. But we're blessed with a narration now from one of our fellow loonies from our Facebook group.
Absolute superstar. Tell you what. He is. Just this man, they don't call him the Moon Knight detective for nothing, probably.
That's right. That's right. He is one hell of a dedicated loony. It is none other than Tommy Cavill. He's from Michigan, USA. And, he grabbed this with gusto, and he's got his narration of Moon Knight, issue 189. So I won't say too much. This is Tommy's guest narration. I must say he wrote, edited, and narrated this all himself as well. So thank you so much, Tommy, for the massive effort. Guys and listeners, if you got a cup of tea or something, just get yourself nice and comfy, because this is a long one, and it's a really nice listen. So let's throw it to Tommy for his bare bones.
What's happening, loonies? Welcome to the Bare Bones. This is Tommy Cavill, your friendly neighborhood high school English teacher, loony for hire, and proud member of the Into the Night community. This week's Bare Bones is Jones and I'm Moon Knight 189, Crazy Runs in the Family Part 2. Written by Max Bemis, penciled by Jason Burroughs, pages 1 through 9 inked by Burroughs and 10 through 20 by Guillermo Ortego, colored by Lopez, lettered by Virtual Calligraphy's Corey Pettit, and edited by Jake Thomas. Cover by Jason Burroughs and Matt Lopez. Released November 29, 2017, 189 was previewed with the question, can Moon Knight handle the truth? Well, much to Nicholson's chagrin, I think our few good men can handle the truth as we finally get our man, well, our men, in Marvel Legacy action. Friday. It's quiet. At least as quiet as a 20-year-old subway train roaring down the tracks can be. A conductor is whistling while he works, safely conducting passengers on New York's underground, thinking about his hot date with his stamp collection. Suddenly, the body of a huge, tattooed man appears behind the driver. Covered in mysterious markings, all midnight, this figure reaches for the driver from the shadows, oddly giving off a phosphorescent blue light. Offended by the driver's content demeanor, this mysterious bulk says aloud that this victim will learn the truth. With one touch, the shadowed figure infects the hapless driver with a nameless infliction. The driver's skin turns a ghastly shade of blue while deep, azure veins crawl across the driver's face. The disease spreads. The driver's eyes are equally afflicted with the vine-like veins but glow with a deep, painful red glaze. Blood oozes from the sockets as the man screams out his new truth, the vision of the assailant. In a final panel, the driver accelerates the train car, dooming himself and all his passengers. The The narrative's paused as we get a little bit of a backstory for our New Moon loonies. Previously in Moon Knight 188, a mysterious nameless patient was admitted to Ravencroft Asylum after committing multiple homicides by fire. Seeking to understand his mental illness, his doctor, using Mark Spector's case as a template, attempted to have her patient see how he, too, can use the allegory of the gods to better understand his obsession. Where Spector turned to the moon god, the man known as Patient 86 found meaning in Amon-Ra, the sun god. He set fire to the asylum with his doctor inside, using nothing but his own body. Patient 86 left, convinced he is the earthly aspect of Amon-Ra, and he is very upset at his son, Khonshu. We're thrown into a five-panel bar fight. As Burroughs and Lopez washed-out design suggests, the setting isn't important. But there's a fish mounted to the wall, closely watching the blood of drug dealers and slavers paint the broken tables and glass-strewn floor. Moon Knight is entered with a proper vengeance and easily takes out the four poorly groomed thugs. After kicking a carbonadium boot in one's face, Moony knocks out the clown by throwing another goon into a pile of depraved flesh. Moon Knight finishes the fray with a swift kick to the fourth man's throat. The fish on the wall is almost smiling. See, Khonshu has been narrating this whole time. He speaks as if everything we see has happened in the past. One can't help but wonder if this legitimizes Khonshu as a reality. Regardless, Khonshu's voice employs alliteration and strong imagery to complement the surgeon-like precision that Mark Spector's Moon Knight uses in the fight. After all, Mark Spector is crazy, but, well, he's also a bloody-knuckled superhero. Changing his nearly pristine all-white tactical suit, cape, and cowl for street clothes, Spectre returns to his apartment, beat up but patched up, in a spotless white peacoat and a soiled white t-shirt. He greets his elderly landlord, carefully, kindly. Her name's Mavis, and he gets ready for bed. His studio, hostel-like apartment is sparsely decorated. In fact, the peeling plaster and box TV give the appearance of an early 2000s Roach motel. Yet, Mark, he seems content. He's tired, but at peace. He carefully irons his Moon Knight regalia before bed and passes out in a tumble of bedsheets. He awakens as Stephen Grant. Khonshu and Mark, presumably established as two of four identities, look on as Stephen gets ready for the day. Khonshu with his lifeless bird skull eye sockets, Mark with a resolute look of faith, neither content nor dismayed, neither proud nor angry. Stephen checks his watch and walks out of his Skid Row digs in a press suit, limo waiting for him. Stephen looks out his car window. We see a scowling Jake Lockley, complete with his jaunty cap and don't-mess-with-me mustache, leering at Stephen in a reflection. Jake is crazy, by the way. If Mark is crazy, Jake is quazy. Still, Stephen Grant seems happy. He has his wealth. He has his station. He has direction. The page turns, setting changes. We move from the muted but colorful world of Stephen Grant to a washed-out soup kitchen. Patient 86 looks like an orange Julius Messiah. He's calm, moves slowly, He's gracious. He too has direction. He's looking for someone. Patient 86 questions a busker who leads him to a smack slinger in a Harlem park. Maybe Marcus Garvey. She hints that the man he is looking for calls himself the Living Death. He sets up shop in the Bronx. Patient 86 questions a drunk hobo, another veteran. That leads to Myra. Myra, an aged escort. She confirms the projects patient 86 is looking for. 86 has found his source. Now just to secure the fix. Return to Stephen Grant and Khonshu's narration. We find out that Stephen Grant has maintained a successful enterprise, even while Mark and his other shades have been away at Ravencroft. Celebrating a great win for the company, we also learn that Stephen has divested himself of the company's holdings and diverted his funds completely to the Lunar Lives Fund. A cover for his work as Moon Knight? A charity for the youth of New York? We quickly learn how Stephen prefers to spend his time as he leaves an after-party and soars into the gaping maw of the night as a crescent-caped Moon Knight. Baby, I set his own fire. Don't you know it's gonna be all right? Well, all right, all right, all right. New page, new strand. It's patient 86. His smile a clementine, his hands a blur of scar tissue. He wants to see the man who acts as ruler of the projects and calmly places a hand on a thug's shoulder. The thug reacts, but patient 86 warns the grunt. Please, he says, I don't want to have to burn you. All while that citrusy smile suggests unparalleled sincerity. The thug presses. 86's eyes become flames, and the smile fades. Patient 86 ignites the guard with nothing but his hand. What was once the grunt is nothing more than cremated remains. And patient 86 calmly walks through the Living Death's door. The crash scene. Flames everywhere. The dead strewn across a platform. Yet others, crazed with blue liquid dripping from their eyes, are being restrained by the cops. Engineers inspect the crash. Moon Knight isn't there to clean up the mess, though. He's there to take out the trash. He sneaks past the wreckage, walks down the tracks, and uses his singular detective skills to seek out his prey. The tunnel takes on a blue light. Moon Knight's white regalia remains. Switching to a utility light on his left gauntlet, Moon Knight enters a storage room and finds his prey. Like a cat keeping watch over its rodent quarry, the villain we come to know simply as the Truth broods in the darkness, his victims squealing their induced nightmares. One victim is self-aware. He claws at Moon Knight, pleading for help. Moon Knight presses forward, shining his wrist-mounted light on the Truth. The Truth cracks his knuckles and then threatens Moon Knight. Next page, different story. Moon Knight sneaks in a right hook, blood is shed, and one of the Truth's four lip rings is ripped right from his flesh. Another cross, the left this time, and a right elbow to the Truth's orbital. Finally, the Truth is frustrated. He raises Moon Knight by the throat and sends his blue sickness through the cowl. It seems that Moon Knight is ready to succumb to the Truth's own truth. There is no Moon God, Moon Knight states. Just another sick delusion. But no, Moon Knight knows what's up. He jabs himself in the face to wake from this misappropriated dream. Something changes. Moon Knight's otherwise pristine mask shows blood. He loves the pain. Grabbing a crescent dart, This newly energized Moon Knight slices the truth in the forearm and shovel kicks the brute in the belly. There's a breath. A beat. Moon Knight speaks to Mark Spector's personalities and quickly switches from Mark Spector Moon Knight to Jake Lockley Moon Knight. Or is it Mr. Knight? Shedding the cowl of Khonshu, this new Moon Knight controlled by Jake Lockley rolls back his face mask and speaks to the truth from a poorly shaven mug. This caped Mr. Knight has had it. He instigates the truth, suggesting he's a sexual predator, spits a loose tooth at the bloodied truth, and Triple Dog dares the truth to try to read Jake Lockley's mind, albeit with a few expletives. Like I said, Jake is flipping crazy. He's also a cab driver. The shadow of Mark Spector reminds Jake Lockley to refrain from murder. But there's a strange energy in the air. The truth is shocked, literally, by the darkness of Lockley's mind, all hidden from Mark. Jake's Moon Knight deftly throws two crescent darts at the truth, piercing the villain in the eyes. Two devil-horned accoutrements. Is he dead? Disabled? Khonshu and Stephen Grant's shades do not approve. A surprising departure for Khonshu, speaking more like Crawley than the Moon God of Vengeance himself. Regardless, Mark Spector's Moon Knight shakes it off. The truth's victims awaken from their poison nightmare. We return to the infiltrated projects. Patient 86 enters with a polite knock. He promises not to take much of the living death's time. In fact, he gets straight to the point. I was put on this earth to destroy Khonshu. Patient 86 states that he is the manifestation of Khonshu's father, Amun-Ra. Patient 86 is personally offended that Khonshu continues to breathe and spread his truth of descent through the fouled avatar Mark Spector. More than that, Mark is a Hebrew, a Jew, a once slave of the Egyptian Empire. Yet, Patient 86 needs help. He needs the living death. The mysterious man they call the Living Death speaks. He admits, Patient 86 is insane, but it takes more than a crazed mortal to take down Mark Spector. A blaze of light, heat, and sizzling wires. Patient 86 ignites the Living Death's console. This isn't any man in a chair. It's Bushman. Raoul Bushman. In the flesh, laughing and pleased that he has a new alliance, another partner in the task to end Mark Spector. Except, well, he's gained some weight. Sure, passionate, crazed, stacked with firepower, but probably real slow. Your face to face with the hey, with that, my fellow loonies, I leave it to our High Priest of Khonshu. Rey, Connor, it's been a blast. Thank you for the fun. I don't know about my performance, but I rate the experience 5 out of 5 crescent darts. Keep Moony weird. Your face to face.
Yes. Well,
that's pretty awesome.
That was an amazing
an odyssey, I tell you what. Thank you very much, Tommy, for that. That is a crazy amount of effort.
Oh gosh.
Thanks so much.
It was so easy to listen to, and I'm just amazed at just the talent, like, in the Loony community. Like, Tommy's Tommy's come in and he's written an awesome, to me, I just had visions of Tom Waits, like the way he's described stuff as well. It's that kind of, you know, seedy kind of atmosphere. It's brilliant. So thank you so much, Tommy.
You're just going to call Tommy seedy.
No. The world he's created with his pro. And I tell you, it's kind of like an audiobook. You can just chuck this on the car and just have a good listen with it. It's fantastic. So yeah, as Tommy's covered in the guest narration, there is a lot that happens in 189. To kick off, Connor, what were the first impressions of the issue as a whole?
Well, it's certainly a different issue from 188, that crazy almost sort of one-shot prelude to all this, and you know, now we're seeing Moon Knight, and I think this is such, in every way, such a different run from everything we've seen before, and even what we saw in the last issue, but I think it's still just as fantastic, just as smartly written, amazing art. I think this is a rather interesting new direction for Moon Knight, and I mean, that's going to be, you know, totally up to everyone of how much they like this interpretation. I love it. But I think Moon Knight has always been great with that sort of malleability. I don't think really any of Moon Knight's runs have been so indicative of another, and this is just a crazy, amazing new vision for our caped, brutal crusader.
Yeah, for sure. And we'll get into those differences as we get into the issues. Rebecca, what were your thoughts?
Kind of the same, that it was another, it's like, it was almost like another issue one.
Mm-hmm.
So we have basically like 188 kind of stands on its own, because it's so much establishing that guy, a patient 86.
Mm-hmm.
And then this is almost like issue one again. So like giving us the status quo for Moon Knight and the setting of the world we're going to be in. It was still had some beautiful writing in it. The art's still amazing.
Yeah, that's great.
And it was just like, it's kind of that world of like slight threat always, madness never quite going away. Unlike possibly the last couple of Moon Knight runs, which are obviously both stellar, it feels more set in today's world.
It does. Yeah, it does. There's a lot more.
And for me, that's probably the big difference is it feels not grounded, because obviously it's not a grounded kind of thing, but like I feel like I can start making parallels to the world around me.
Well, you get...
And just leaves me wanting more, which, I mean, you know, is a good thing.
Yeah, I think Bemis has done really well to... I think what you're saying, Rebecca, as well, he kind of gives a flavour for the city that Moon Knight's in. So
yeah, exactly.
You get these flurry of characters like Mavis at the hotel, and you get these the people that Patient 86 questions. So you get a bit of a slice of the life in the city. And I think it's from that kind of all these different people, like, you know, the escort and the old war veteran who's a hobo, and you get a...
But
yeah.
Then even on the other side, the businessman that Steven's hanging out with,
yes,
and his charity's trying to achieve, so what problems there are with feeding people, and it's just so like we're getting the whole sort of gamut of like what the rich people and the poor and the
you're getting
random people on the streets.
That's true. Getting such a different range of people. It's like to also bring it back at what you were saying about it could be easily be like a first issue, which I totally agree, because although issue 188 set up patient 86, if you look at this issue, the truth kind of just kind of appears out of nowhere. And if you were to look at this as a first issue, you could say the same for Patient 86. Like, he's introduced, you know, with a glowing orange to him in contrast to everything. And he's just another figure that's
roaming in
the
streets. That was an interesting choice.
That was a beautiful choice.
It was a really, the colours. And I think it's Ortigo's inks, I reckon, has just really augmented Burroughs's...
Ortigo inks the last 10 pages.
Last 10 pages.
So Burroughs does 1 to 9, Ortega does 10 to 20.
Well, he, I mean, Burrows does a great job with...
Nobody correct me on my maths, please.
Well, actually, the inking all round is fantastic. And again, it's that same surprise that you get of the level of detail that Burrows goes into. And I think it really comes out with the inking as well.
So much detail.
So I mean, beautiful.
It shocked me a couple of times. Yeah. And when the firemen are putting out the train.
Yeah, that was a great shot.
So many things going on in the background.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And then there's that reveal shot of the truth sitting in that room in the dark, and you have these victims writhing around. But you look at their clothing; it's just really luscious with line work. It's really good. Look, I agree with both of you as well. It was a really strong issue, but I can see there are a lot of points to it that may divide some fans' opinions. Let's kind of tease that out with our aspects. Connor, do you want to go first?
Sure. Well, I'm not sure where to start. Shall we start with Mark and his personalities or Khonshu as our narrator?
Oh, let's go with our personalities and Mark.
All right. Well, it's certainly a big change up, especially for, I think Jake's the real big one here. I think
we've
seen more in this of Stephen Grant in this run than we've probably seen a lot of before outside of the awesome work between Mark and Stephen and the Lemire run. And Mark, we probably see the least of in this issue, actually.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think the big change up is this crazy, new, brutal Jake personality. Well, not new, but like newly written.
Yeah, it was teased a bit. Apparently, one of the loonies posted up on the group. There was it was alluded to in I think a previous run that Jake's a bit of a loose cannon. But it's certainly not. If you look at the whole history of it, it's certainly not kind of shown up until only just recently. Rebecca, what were your thoughts on Jake being I guess so different?
It was interesting. I was like, I think after the Lemire run, there's kind of maybe like a rejiggling, you know, if he's kind of not at peace with his personalities, but maybe there's some redefinitions of lines in there. I mean, I think it didn't upset me.
No.
I was just, it led me going like, is this, have we seen this before?
Yeah.
I liked seeing more of Stephen as well.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, the art kind of when you first see Jake and he's doing that side eye, it kind of shows you that like, maybe there's something. I liked how it was written and I liked how it came about and I'm not going to think too much about like how that fits into the grand scheme of thing, because I have a feeling we will find out.
Yeah, I mean, it did kind of raise an eyebrow with me, I'm not too fussed with it. And in hindsight, looking at the previous run with Jeff Lemire, let's not forget as well that Jake Lockley was dressed up as Moon Knight in that last arc in particular. So he had an affinity for I wouldn't say just violence, but for crusading. There is a tentative link over there as well. And I believe, it will kind of be brought out later on. So it definitely is interesting. As a lot of other loonies are spectrolating, Jake Lockley could be Mr. Knight, as Tommy mentioned in his narration as well.
I liked how he pulled up the mask and...
Yeah.
You can see that. Yeah. I liked how I think that won me over.
Mm.
Like, you know, just like that kind of physical change and the physical, like, I'm going to be this, like, I'm going to do the hyper violence.
Yeah.
That persuaded me more than thinking about it too much.
Well, look, yeah, actually, totally.
Yeah.
Agree.
Sorry, Connor? Yeah.
Oh, no, I was just agreeing.
Oh, yeah. Look, a little nitpick, and don't want to be the killjoy here, but. What I do like seeing Jake Lockley with his mouth revealed and him still masked. He looks very much like a superhero. He's produced a 5 o'clock shadow, which Stephen Grant didn't have previous. So was that was that like grown really, really quickly when he changes personalities? I don't know, but it definitely defines the different personalities. But you know, we did see Steven not long ago.
There's a little bit of a leeway when you're doing with the DID kind of stuff, because we're not. I mean, I guess that's what we're seeing, but it could also be what Mark's seeing, and I don't know.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. True.
It's a little bit. You're right. It's a little bit. I love people that notice these things, because I really don't. I get so lost in it. I wouldn't even be able to tell you if Stephen Grant had 5 o'clock shadow. Go back and have a look. No, he didn't.
You want to go, Ray?
No, sorry, Connor.
I was going to say. Yeah, no, I just kind of agree that it was kind of funny. He was talking about, like, swapping over personalities in the middle of the fight, and Truce just kind of sitting there like, yeah, do your thing, just swapping over.
I love that.
Give your mum a call.
Yeah, it just makes him look all the more crazy and unpredictable for his foes. Like, when this guy is just vocalizing, you know, that he's, oh, what should I be now today? Oh, look, I'm not going to use him. I'm going to use him. It just really highlights how crazy Moon Knight is. And I thought that was a nice touch by Bemis. Because you generally, it's more of an internal monologue, it seems, prior. The only other one that really stands out for me was in Houston's run. I think it was issue 14, where he's being interviewed by the psychiatrist as to be assessed to get a registration card or not, a superhero registration card. And he flips personalities, like, just from one to the other. And it's actually quite scary to see. This kind of, is more obvious as well, like him just saying, oh, look, I'm going to use this guy because Stephen Grant's not going to help, you know, in this situation. And I just like that, how that was kind of well shown. I just want to also mention, Rebecca, you were saying that you like more of Stephen Grant here as well. He's actually also a little different, because previously we saw him in the media industry, like as a film producer. And
yes, now we have him as a businessman.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's not really elaborated on, so he could still be part of that, but
because they're really just talking about his investments and
stuff.
They're not sort of, we still don't really, I mean, there's still no mention about what he actually does, just that he's rich and has a portfolio, and gives a lot to charity. So I was thinking that maybe moved on up to the sort of executive level in media.
True.
Love him here, and just sort of, just how much I love sort of seeing him more invested and doing sort of nicer things as the nicer personality, with still that hint of being kind of a crazed superhero vigilante. But it was like, it just made him seem really involved and really seem like a part of Mark's world, instead of a good disguise to get around to different functions for the plot to advance or something.
Yeah, because he didn't seem overly philanthropic, Stephen Grant, in previous runs, right? He was just, well, in the Lemire run, he was just pretty much invested in getting that film to happen, and obviously there was no charity work or anything like that. So that was a nice touch to have him do something a little more for the society, rather than just films. Well, how about the next aspect, which would be another talking point, and that would be, as Connor mentioned, Khonshu. What are your thoughts, Rebecca, on how Khonshu was depicted in this issue? Very different.
Very different. But you know what? After the last run, I quite liked it.
Yeah?
I quite liked having him... I guess we're assuming manifesting as a personality.
Mm-hmm.
In amongst the other ones. Not entirely sure he is a trusted narrator.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're doing a bit unreliable narrating, but I'm fine with that. I quite like him. It's interesting. It's because he still has a few moments about of being sort of snide. You know, he's always calling him pathetic in the past, and there's a slight element of that.
Yep.
Which kept it just enough on the Khonshu side for me.
Yes.
I also I know we talked briefly about the use of multiple personality disorder.
Ah, yes.
Here. Yeah. And I decided afterwards I was prepared to forgive it for it being coming from Khonshu.
Oh, okay, yes, yes. Well, that's true as well. It is his narration, yeah.
It's his narration. Because I went back and looked at it and went, do you know what? If Khonshu's saying it,
yeah,
I have less problems with it than... It's not a term that's widely in use these days anymore. As everyone's moved to dissociative identity disorder, but I figure Khonshu can get away with it.
It is a bit old fashioned still.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No. I liked the
lettering change for him.
Yeah. Corey Petit still doing again. His classic Khonshu lettering. Shout out to Corey Petit.
Yeah. Very much so. And it's a great way, of kind of tying it into the previous run as well.
I think it's another of those things that made me just want more. I was just like, I want to know more about this. I want to know more about Stephen Grant. I want to know more about Jake. I want to know more about Khonshu. I want to know more about all of them. So I guess it did its job.
Yeah, no, for sure. I mean, it's definitely, I think Khonshu is under the thumb of Moon Knight. And that's off the back of the previous run, which is good. Like you, Rebecca, I'm just waiting. He's not totally compliant. You know, as you say, he's got some snide remarks here and there. And look, with Patient 86 and Armin Ra out there, I have a feeling Khonshu is going to be needed a lot more in a greater capacity. So he might be unshackled later on down the run. We don't know. But it's a very interesting take on Khonshu. Some of the loonies weren't they weren't really for it. I guess they felt uncomfortable with how Khonshu being this deity that has always been on Mark's back about something now kind of taking a back seat. But yeah, look, we're only on the second issue, and let's give it some time. And Connor, what do you think of Khonshu's rebirth?
He was honestly probably like the most jarring thing about this issue when it comes to adjusting yourself from the previous runs. I was like, holy crap, like this guy seems a lot nicer and a lot friendlier than how he was in the previous run. But that also being confirmed by Bemis on Twitter as officially in this run, all in his head. I think it kind of works, you know. Mark sort of fought his inner demons, and possibly that as well could be Khonshu's presence and how he feels about how he's become. So it'd possibly make a lot of sense too that, you know, if he's vanquished what he thought was such a violent part of his life and sort of made him feel more at peace with himself, that Khonshu, as Rebecca said, possibly even just another personality represented as something a bit nicer. And I like, especially as Tommy indicated in his bare bones, that it isn't like, oh, hey, Mark, how you doing? Good morning. Hey. It's still kind of like this almost working relationship, you know. Khonshu compliments him on, like, dressing well for work, but apart from that, it doesn't seem entirely personal. And I really like that, and I think how Khonshu was written is really enjoyable to read, and if he's a continual narrator, I don't think I'll ever get tired of that sort of narration style. So probably the most jarring, but I think such an interesting and cool thing that I ended up really enjoying in the end.
Yeah. And a quick shout out as well to again Tommy. He called it early on in the primer pages, saying that Khonshu would become one of the aspects.
True, yeah.
So he was right on the money there. So yeah, no, well,
I'll
done.
Myself, I didn't believe him. I didn't believe him.
Yeah, I was a skeptical, but nope, it's proven wrong. So,
I also think it's incredibly assured of Bemis to come into a character like Moon Knight, especially after the last few runs, and just pretty much lay out his manifesto here.
Yeah,
you know, we're doing things differently. You know, I don't know, I would be terrified, personally. I fully applaud it for that. Oh. That's why, and you know, we've got plenty of issues to go through that we might have issues with down the line. But as this opening rally, I'm like, yeah, go for it.
Totally. He such a bold move by Bemis. I mean, this from the first issue, 188, not featuring Moon Knight as well. So Bemis is not afraid to do, you know, to shake things up a little, which is really great to see. So, we can only wait and see. Also, as well, the point with Khonshu, I wanted to make perhaps what Bemis is also doing, if we contrast Khonshu to Amon-Ra, or the Sun King, and what was described in 188, the Sun King being more of the aggressor and more of the, you know, I guess the fiery temperament, whereas Khonshu is meant to show that more calmer side. Maybe this is how Bemis kind of contrasts the two between each other. So, yeah, just a thought. So Khonshu is a big one, definitely. What else have we... we also have, obviously, one of the big intros. This is an interesting one, the truth, is one of our aspects. We've had articles stating that, you know, the Sun King and the truth are going to be two big bads for Moon Knight, and they're going to be part of canon for the Moon Knight corner of the universe. We see, potentially, the truth die in this issue straight away. What are your thoughts, Connor?
Shocking. It just seemed like such a build-up. I really expected another, like, 188 where we got the Sun King's introduction. It's like, bam, get ready, Mark Spector. This guy's about to destroy your life, but no. Two crescent darts to the eyes that everyone seems, like, sort of to assume it killed him. Like, everyone's reaction to... Jake throwing the crescent darts. Although, sorry, I'm gonna butcher your name, man. But one of our loonies and in the group and in the chat room, Midkine.
Oh, yes, King? Yes.
He pointed out that possibly Dr. Emmett surviving those flames, meaning that the Sun King might even, like, sort of necromancy make the truth his sort of own member of his little anti-Mark posse that we see forming, and I think that possibly is the way to go. If the truth is dead, he might still be alive and just find a way to reenact revenge blind.
Yeah, I certainly hope the truth will be back. He's an interesting character, despite, you know, the brevity that he was in this issue. So I'd like to see more of him and learn more about him. But I do admire, again, from Bemis. There was a bit of smoke and mirrors, I guess, in the articles, because I was thrown by, you know, just the shock of him dying, and it was one of the most one of the impacts in this issue. So so I thought that was a pretty cool thing, how what Bemis did pulling the strings there. What are your thoughts on the truth, Rebecca?
Well, I'm devastated it wasn't connected to
Dr. Emmett, for sure.
Obviously.
Yes.
But no, I'm not. I thought it was I love his power.
Yeah.
I love it. I hope we do get some aspect of him back. I was surprised what happened. I mean, like, it reminded me how much promo stuff lies.
Yes.
you have to remember the whole pre-Hydra Cap thing. There was a lot of lying going on. But I'm willing to take it for that kind of surprise. But I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if he comes back in some way or form. If not, then I enjoyed my issue with him.
Yeah, true. I mean, I hope it won't kind of detract from it, you know, trying to expect to see him come back. It was a good effect that Bemis did, and he was interesting enough. I hope maybe even in flashbacks we might see him. I don't know, but it'll be good to learn more about him.
I did enjoy the crescent darts to the eyes.
In the very superhero moment there with Moon Knight chucking them over. So it was a bit of a surprise. Look, there are a few more aspects. Well, there's one other big one, but I wanted to also just touch, because there's so many big characters in this issue. So I just wanted to gather your thoughts on, we see Patient 86. I thought he was done really well, almost something unnerving about him being so calm about everything.
Oh, I loved it.
Yeah.
I love him. I love him. I know we've only had him for two issues, but I love him.
Yeah.
He's like this walking murderous hippie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's just the fact that he's got all this power behind him. It's quite scary, actually.
It's like nothing to him to light people on fire. Like, there's no physical exertion or anything. It's just... goddamn.
Yeah.
Terrifying.
Yeah. And the other big big personality in this issue was the end, was Bushman. What did you think of how he was introduced? Certainly, again, another unexpected... unexpected thing, like, you know, the second last page, you saw his teeth and the makeup in a close up of his mouth. So I was like, oh, okay, yep, it's Bushman. We know it's Bushman. Then you turn the page, and it's Bushman not looking.
No body shaming.
But, like, you know, he's different from what he had looked prior.
He is.
Mm. So there's a story behind that as well. So I love how Bemis is he's dropping all these things, you know. Mm-hmm. So all that we're left with are like more and more questions. What I thought with Bushman as well, I thought it was good that he was revealed like in this second issue, because I felt, you know, Lemire had done that in the previous run, like by having, you know, a big last page reveal of Bushman. And I don't know, for me, it just felt as if that's been used as well, like in previous runs. So it was kind of like, oh gosh, you know, it's a bit of a trope kind of within the Moon Knight thing. So I'm glad that Bemis has kind of changed it up a little and has done it straight away. I thought that was, I thought that was pretty cool.
Just on the subject of the body shaming as a weird segue, I did actually like that, you know, it was obviously the reveal, like the final page reveal, and was like supposed to be a bit jarring and shocking, but at least like I also like that wasn't really used as like a weird sort of comedy at the end of the issue too. Like, I like sort of how, like, for this big change up, it's kind of nice how plain it was presented, and that like very interesting change. But it seems like Bemis seems assured in it, and just taking that path just sort of shows his assurity in changing up the game when it comes to Moon Knight.
Yeah, and it's quite fortuitous. We actually you know, doing the Bushman spotlight, which we did coincidentally plan to do before actually having read this issue. So you know, Khonshu must be looking down on us when we were organizing this episode. Before we go into I guess the spotlight, we've got a couple of things just to wrap up with this issue. Like, any notes? I put down a few. First of it being a roundabout wave that we haven't actually seen yet any of Mark's supporting cast, like Frenchie and Marlene. Also, you know, Samuel's, was he driving the limo? You'd assume that he would be if he's under the employ of Stephen Grant, but you know, that's only just assuming. Hope to see them soon. Are you guys missing them, or what are your thoughts on the characters to date? I mean, there's a lot of new characters that he's introducing, so I guess that's taking a lot of time.
Yeah,
but
I'm not missing them yet.
Yeah, yeah. Like,
I mean, eventually I'll want to know. Yeah. What their status is, but right now I'm enjoying the new stuff.
Mm, yeah, there's a lot of new stuff, I guess, to kind of feed through.
It's definitely not like sort of my heart's aching not seeing them. I like sort of seeing Mark in such a different setting, and knowing that that with Bemis confirming that they will play like an important part and come back into Mark's life later in the run, as of course they would, but it's just kind of interesting knowing that's coming, and we're seeing the setup for a whole new Mark and this whole new setting, and the when we finally get to seeing them again, I think it'll be really rewarding and an interesting setup and issue from everything we've got before. So
yeah,
I like sort of the spaced out.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, we are, I guess, only on the second issue. Oh, I'm kind of missing Frenchie. I kind of want him to, because we did see him. I know it was all in his head, but we did see him die in the previous run, albeit apart from the flashbacks. So, you know, I'd just like to get some assurance that what Frenchie's up to. It'd be good to see Gina and Crawley as well. So yeah, I guess we'll just bide our time. We've got As mentioned, there's a lot of characters that Bemis is introducing and trying to set up. So, yeah, we shall wait and see. The other notes I had was that Mark / Stephen Grant still living in a roach motel, as Tommy put it in the narration. Again, questions are asked, like, why isn't he at Grant Manor, or what is he doing there again? I think, Connor, you mentioned briefly that in one of the, is it the Bun Run, that he had been living in an apartment, Mark Spector, or was it the Wood Run?
He was living in like a weird sort of out of town, like mansion, wasn't he, or something?
Oh, was he?
Yeah. I remember that at the start of the run. It might have changed by the time we got to the Bun part, but I remember in Ellis, it was like a really dusty.
Yeah, Ellis.
It might have even been like the rundown Grant Mansion, but
yeah, I think it did start there. But I think he did. Maybe it was one of his safe houses or something. Maybe he has something like the Punisher. Some safe houses all over the city. But yeah, again, more questions that we hope will be revealed later on. Just looking at notes here, I think we've covered all the other...
Yeah.
Is the one walking hippie, Sun King doing his thing. I think that's yours, Connor, isn't it? Yeah. All right, well, Crescent Dart ratings. What would you guys give issue 189? Rebecca?
Oh, I always have to go first.
Hey, it's me every other week. Come on.
Yeah. 3.5. I'm going to judge it harshly.
Ah, okay. So you enjoy it?
But not because I didn't enjoy it.
No, I just...
Yeah, I think...
Get out of this house.
No, I think there's some space to go. Some space to go before I go up to the fives. And so somewhere between three... If I was being accurate, 3.75. But I don't really approve of those cheap methods. So I'll go 3.5 and give it some growing room.
How about relative to 188? Would you rate it higher or lower?
Just lower. But okay. Not by a massive amount, yeah.
It was a very different issue, wasn't it, to 188?
Yeah.
So. How about you, Connor?
I'd agree. I'd probably give it a 4 out of 5.
Mm-hmm.
I'd probably give it. I like... the first one was 188, more so than the one issue, I don't know.
Yes.
Was sort of very different the way how it felt, so complete and rounded. This is still... And one thing I forgot to mention about Khonshu, this is still very... an introductory issue. This is really done in getting new readers into Moon Knight. Like, the truth being sort of, even if he does come back, he worked really well as a one-off, like, almost Monster of the Week villain.
Mm-hmm.
We got Khonshu narrating it, and obviously that doesn't make it the most, like, explosive, well, 5 out of 5 issue, but, I mean, the writing, like, hasn't declined. It's still just as strong for what this issue wanted to do. We just can't rave enough about the art and the colours.
Oh, gosh, the art,
like,
is
the
brilliant.
Sequence in the... tunnels where we got the new Inca on Burrow's art, and we saw the light on his wrist flash up, and how that played the room was just incredible detail, and like how brutal Burrow's is, how effective it is. I love seeing like specific details of like Mark hitting the truth in the face, and that rips out
The ring.
Mouth ring. Yeah. It's just, it, like, from an art and writing perspective, like, obviously it's just as fantastic. But just the way the issue is, I think it's definitely a 4 out of 5.
And, I'd have to agree with Connor. I'd say 4 out of 5 as well. I really enjoyed it. Different to 188, as mentioned. Look, it plays a lot to my morbid want for seeing Moon Knight dish out violence. So there was a lot of fighting, and I just love how he's such an aggressive superhero. Like, he's faced with this rather large guy in the truth, and he just launches into him. And obviously his introduction as well in the bar scene, which we saw in one of the previews, but we see again. I just thought it was great. It was very different, but as you mentioned, it was a setup issue as well. And I have to also mention as well, impressed with Burroughs's art. I think can't say that enough. Like, we were given Smallwood, absolutely incredible artist, and Moon Knight's fallen into having another great artist. So as Moon Knight fans, you're just so lucky. And I just wanted to mention, as you said, Connor, that shining light panel with Moon Knight, the colors there were really good. The train scene, I actually thought as well, I'd have to point out the introduction of Mark Spector as he goes into the hotel. He's one cut dude, you know? He goes up to the hotel and he's ironing.
I can't see, I noticed.
But I love how he's got the old Sin City Marv, you know, band-aids on his face, and he's kind of all a bit, you know, a bit rough and ready, but he's still in peak condition. So fantastic art from Burroughs, and I can't stress that enough as well.
I like that he irons his Moon Knight.
I found that hilarious. I mean,
so did I. Yeah,
I thought it was just a business shirt at first, but then you see the close up, there's a moon there, so it's just like, oh my god. But also the detail with like the people on the streets that patient 86 see. Just
so much detail. Level of detail. Guy's tattoos on his arms.
Oh my gosh! Oh. It's So that was,
like, punk outfit, especially, was just loaded
amazing.
With detail.
Very good. He must have blown that up really big and just reduced it to get all that detail in. But those sorts of things kind of won me over for it. And with those divisive, you know, elements in the book, look, I'm not too worried about it. Bemis wants to shake the tree, and he's done that. So. I'm just going to see what pans out. So, that was average, 3.8 something. It was a pretty good issue, guys. I thought that was, highly enjoyable. Oh, also as well, I see Stephen Grant has that scar on his left eyebrow still. So nice little detail touch there with Mark Spector's.
There's some just beautiful stuff. Is. And they go from... There's another bit where they have, like, right at the beginning when it's Khonshu narrating, they've got the fuzzy panel edges, and then you go to the really sharp panel edges again.
Oh,
there's
gosh.
There's some really nice touches.
Nice touches, yep. Brilliant. Yeah, I didn't notice that.
I just love it, and the colouring is amazing.
Yeah, the colouring is good. Lopez, I hope he sticks around Marvel for a lot longer as well. He's definitely a talent. Well, with that segue of the final reveal of the issue, we have... how are we going for time, guys? I think we might hold off on the Funko Pop review if that's cool. We can do that with gusto in another episode. Let's look at, again, information compiled by our loony on the street, Tommy Cavill. He's given us some information on Bushman. And we spotlighted Morpheus and Stained Glass Scarlet previously. And we thought it's high time we better give you a bit of a rundown. Any new potential new Loony or Moon Knight fans out there with Bushman? So, let's kick it off. Look, I'll just go first. Bushman's also known as Raoul Bushman, and he appeared in Moon Knight Volume 1 in 1980, number 1, and issues 9 to 10. He was in Mark Spector Moon Knight, which started off in 1989, issues 1 to 3, 11 to 16, and 37. He also was shown in the 1998 Moon Knight run, issues 1, 3, and 4. The Houston run in Moon Knight, 2006, issues 2 to 4, and in issue 6. In Horitz's Vengeance of the Moon Knight in 2009, he was shown... in issues 2 to 6 there, I think predominantly as kind of like a resurrected villain. He was in the Heroic Age Villains 2011 issue 1, and in Moon Knight the run prior in 2016 issues 12 to 13. Rebecca, how about Bushman's any known powers and abilities?
He has no known superhuman powers. He's the peak human physical strength, highly athletic and agile. He's an expert in hand-to-hand combat, but with no known discipline in fighting arts. It's assumed he's received some formal training, though. He's an expert in guerrilla warfare and deception techniques, highly proficient in the use of most conventional firearms. He's often depicted with sharpened metal teeth, with his teeth serving as a hidden weapon, as they would.
As they would, yeah. They're like gold teeth, I think, as well, aren't they? So, yeah.
I wouldn't know which metal, but...
yeah, true. It might be...
gold wouldn't be great, though, for it. Just pointing that out.
Oh, okay.
Because
Wouldn't that leave such a bad...
All the scientists in my family would point that out if I was, like, you know...
That leave a bad taste in your mouth, I suppose?
Well, it's just too soft. You'd
true.
Like, oh, okay.
You'd have to, yeah.
It would have to be, like, a low grade of gold or mixed with something else.
Ah, yes.
Gold colour.
Yeah, that's true.
So...
yeah, and, Connor, I'll give you the opportunity to go through the biography. Look, Loonies, we'll have these in the show notes, so it's quite extensive from Tommy. But maybe the basics, Connor?
Yeah. Well, his basics are Raoul Bushman, yeah. Former soldier of fortune who worked predominantly within African states. Ultimately, he was admitted as a patient at Ravencroft Asylum in New York. Prior to Moon Knight's presence on American streets, Bushman led a team of mercenaries, with Mark Spector as his lieutenant, and Jean-Paul Frenchy Duchamp as another mercenary in the corps, history presented below. Bushman was admitted to Ravencroft after an important battle with Moon Knight in Vengeance of the Moon Knight 6. Based upon later Moon Knight series, it has been implied that Bushman is of Western descent, perhaps American-born or from Western Europe.
Look, there's not really much more to it, I guess, unless... we'll put these in the show notes and you have a good read through, but
Tommy mentions he has stainless steel glass, steel teeth.
Okay, so it's stainless steel.
Steel teeth later on.
Yeah.
Not stainless, I made that up. Just steel.
just the steel.
That makes sense.
Fair enough.
Sorry, I misread it. yeah, so that answers that before he lets us know that.
Oh, yes.
It's not gold.
True. How about who up to Connor? Rebecca. Notable quotes.
Notable quotes from Moon Knight 1980 issue 2, and I'll grant you this much, Spectre. You did stop me, but only temporarily. You see, in a way, I created you, Moon Knight. It wasn't the broken statue down there. It was me. And if I had the power to create you, I certainly have the power to destroy you just as easily as I destroyed the statue. And then from Mark Spector, Moon Knight, 1987, issues 11-14. Your precious king is dead, Moon Knight. You've lost the soul possessing you. You're already dead, deader than you were in that tomb before Khonshu supposedly resurrected you. And another one. Mm-hmm. And the snarled words have their desired effect. Despite Moon Knight's rational thoughts to the contrary, he feels an empty numbness, the loss of life, a spiritual vacuum.
Yes, he's... He's definitely a taunter to Moon Knight and to Mark.
He's definitely a taunter, and he definitely likes to bring it back to Khonshu and Mark's death.
He does. Yeah. I wonder if... I wonder Bushman's take on Khonshu as well. That quote that you mentioned, he seems quite sceptical at the whole Khonshu thing. So in this latest run with Bemis... you know, with his guy saying that he serves Amon-Ra, I wonder how he would take on this guy and how much he would believe in that, the Sun King and Khonshu. I'm not too sure.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see how he reacts to Patient 86 as well, coming as Ra.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah. Well, he's got, I guess you can't argue with the fire. So he's got,
you certainly cannot argue with the fire.
No.
I wouldn't
as well. Connor, and finally, I guess the physical appearance of Bushman.
Bushman is easily recognized by his white death's head mask, also called Demon Skull, tattooed on his face. Beyond this, he is usually depicted in military/mercenary fatigues, tactical vest, pants, boots. He's also known for his sharpened steel teeth that he sometimes employs as a weapon. And B, when Bushman appeared in his undercover attempt to assassinate Russian ambassadors, the death's head tattoo was missing. At the time, he sported only a dark, less conspicuous, ray-like design on his forehead. Resulting from Moon Knight's act of murder and decision to skin Bushman's face with a crescent dart in Houston's run, series 2006, Bushman has been depicted as a faceless monstrosity in several issues. Houston's Khonshu uses the image of the faceless Bushman to terrorize Spectre. Hurwitz Bushman is resurrected without his face, only to ask for his face to be returned with his new life. Bushman then replaces his skin face with staples and wears his former skin as a new mask. Several of Bushman's headshots used in Vengeance of the Moon Knight were clear models for issues 12 to 13 in Lemire's 2016 Moon Knight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wasn't there... Was there like a Joker? Do you reckon there might have been a bit of cross-pollination there with Wasn't there a run where the Joker stapled his face on himself? I'm not a big enough Batman fan.
I would be surprised, but that's kind
of cool. Oh, yeah, that's the big death of the family. Trade of the new 52 Snyder run.
Yeah. So there's a bit of a Joker-esque thing there with Bushman. But, he's... and I think one
I think Hurwitz predated.
Oh, he did.
Run.
Oh, great.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yay, we win.
There's no comparisons between Moon Knight and Batman. Can we just stop this?
Maybe Ray's the biggest perpetrator of this all along, and we just didn't know.
Yeah.
But I think, as we mentioned in one of the other articles as well, Bushman would definitely have to be censored if he ever were to make it, into the MCU or the Netflix, because he is just surrounded with grisly details, especially with his face being cut off. But there,
that little thing.
But there you have it, Loonies. That was a spotlight on Bushman. As mentioned in the show notes, I'm going to put Tommy's awesome in-depth work on Bushman on there for you to read.
If you're new to Moon Knight at all, or like just jumping in, as we know a few listeners are, by all means check that out. Fully detailed, fantastic. Thank you once again, Tommy. You're absolute legend.
Yeah,
it is awesome.
Thank you so much, Tommy. That leads into, I guess, we're almost done. That leads us to just a spectacle. Again, we'd like to thank Tommy Cavill from Michigan, USA again. Thank you so much for all your hard work. It certainly was a surprise, and it's been nice chatting with you as well, and to hear that you've enjoyed it. So hopefully we can have you on again some other time as well. And finally, I guess, Connor, any other final thoughts, Rebecca or Connor, on the issue 189? No.
I can't wait for the next
one. Yeah.
Which I can say,
and
the truth is, the issue was pretty good.
Was that
a good issue?
Yeah, it was a good issue.
I'm gonna come and punch you.
and we're back to monthly then, aren't we? So,
yeah.
190.
Yeah, I think it's the 20th or 27th of this month. We received the big issue 190, Moon Knight versus Sun King.
That will be good.
I know,
a big one.
promo image.
Yes. Oh, gosh, can't wait. But between now and then, I guess we can reread 188 and 189 until that comes. Mm-hmm. Connor, where can all the loonies or any potential loonies find us?
Plenty of loonies. In fact, all of the loonies can find us on our website, intothenightpodcast.wordpress.com. You can email us any thoughts, questions, queries, anything at moonknightpodcast@gmail.com. Our Facebook page is facebook.com/ITKMoonKnight. And our Facebook group, where we've met people like Tommy and plenty of other great loonies, is facebook.com/groups/intothenight. Get in there. Moon Knight discussion 24/7. It might be dawning, but it's a lot of fun. Our Twitter handle is @ITKMoonKnight. We've got Instagram, Tumblr, YouTube. Search for Into the Night, a Moon Knight podcast. You're bound to find us. Hopefully Google doesn't hate us that much. And just about every podcast catcher, you better believe it. We'll probably be there.
We're out there. So, give us, tell your friends. Give us a go. I forgot to mention also next phase. We'll have... we'll continue on our classic run, so we'll have Defenders. It's issue 48. If you remember, a while back we actually reviewed Defenders 47, which is technically the next Moon Knight appearance if we're going to go chronologically. But we'll go to issue 48, and we also, Connor, I believe, will be doing Resurrection War.
Hell yeah, we will be.
Hell yeah,
as a sort of newer run.
Yeah, to kick off a new run. So that's a smaller arc, four parts to that. Rebecca, have you read Resurrection War?
Not for a long time.
Ooh, I've never read it before. This will be my first.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah, it's good art and a good
it
story.
Is, yeah.
So looking forward to that. Rebecca, once again, thank you so much for coming on, and thank you, Larky. Surprisingly, was Larky around or?
She's been on the windowsill the whole time.
Wow, really?
Occasionally, yeah. She's been very quiet because she's trying to be a good girl and be let out.
Yeah, hasn't nuzzled against your mouse trying to grab your attention?
No, she had a little purr down the microphone, but it was a bit quiet. So.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, mostly she just wants to. She's in my arms right now.
Ah, very sweet. Little Macy waltzed in. I'm not sure if it picked it up on the microphone. He let out a little meow, but have a listen there. But he's waltzed back out again. All right. Well, I think that about wraps it. Connor, can I throw? I was about to say, can I throw you out? No, that's not it. Can I ask you?
I didn't realize I was doing that bad a job. Jesus.
Can I ask you to? Can I throw to you to sign us off?
Thank you all so much for listening. Thank you, Rebecca, for coming on as always. Thank you, Ray, for hating me so much, apparently. And may Khonshu watch over the denizens of the night. Thanks again, everyone. Bye bye.
Bye.
Catch you later.
Moon Knight and affiliated characters, stories, and events are properties of Marvel Characters Incorporated. Materials used and discussed within the podcast are intended for critique and review purposes only under the fair dealing concept of the current Copyright Act. The views, information, or opinions expressed during the podcast are solely those of the individuals involved and do not necessarily represent those of the copyright owners.